And we will read responsibly. The fools say in their heart, there is no God. They are corrupt, they do abominable deeds, there is none who does good. The Lord looks down from heaven on us, his children, to see if there are any who understand, who seek after God. We have all turned aside. Together we have become corrupt. There is none who does good, not even one. Thus says the Lord, have they no knowledge, all the evildoers who eat up my people as they eat bread and do not call upon the Lord? There they are in great terror, for God is with the generation of the righteous. Thank the Lord, he makes us righteous. The evil one would shame the plans of the Lord's children, but the Lord is their refuge. Call upon the Lord to continue to be our salvation. The Lord restores our blessings in Christ. Let us rejoice and be glad in his mercy and faithfulness to us. Please join in the gathering hymn, Here I Am to Worship.
Whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for you, and for his sake, God forgives you all of your sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Merciful Father, many times we honor you with our lips, but our hearts are far from you, and we worship you in vain, trusting in ourselves and distrusting you and your faithful promises. Do not let us neglect your commandments and hold to human traditions and made-up laws. We ask you to keep us steadfast in your word. Continue to forgive us and give us your faith so that we grow closer and more dependent on you. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
The first reading is from Isaiah, the 29th chapter. And the vision of all this has become to you like the words of a book that is sealed. When men give it to one who can read, saying, "Read this," he says, "I cannot, for it is sealed." And when they give the book to one who cannot read, saying, "Read this," he says, "I cannot read." And the Lord said, "Because this people draw near with their mouth and honor me with their lips, while their hearts are far from me, and their fear of me is a commandment taught by men. Therefore, behold, I will again do wonderful things with this people, with wonder upon wonder, and the wisdom of their wise men shall perish, and the discernment of their discerning men shall be hidden. Ah, you who hide deep from the Lord your counsel, whose deeds are in the dark, and who say, 'Who sees us? Who knows us?' You turn things upside down. Shall the potter be regarded as the clay, that the things made should say of its maker, 'He did not make me'? Or the thing formed say of him who formed it, 'He has no understanding'? Is it not yet a very little while until Lebanon shall be turned into a fruitful field, and the fruitful field shall be regarded as a forest? In that day the deaf shall hear the words of a book, and out of their gloom and darkness the eyes of the blind shall see. The meek shall obtain fresh joy in the Lord, and the poor among mankind shall exult in the Holy One of Israel." The word of the Lord. The second reading is from Ephesians, the fifth chapter. Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and is himself its Savior. Now as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit in everything to their husbands. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. In the same way, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ does the church, because we are members of his body. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This mystery is profound, and I am saying that it refers to Christ and the church. However, let each one of you love his wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I would like to invite our children who like to come forward and
hear about what we're talking today.
Yeah, good. All right. So today we are hearing a lot of things about who we are, as we always do, and about who Jesus is for us, right? So I want to ask you a question. Do you wash your hands?
I wish for a
blueberry. Yeah. How about how many times have you washed your hands today?
1,000?
Or maybe not even? It's okay if you say, oh, I forgot. Oh, you couldn't reach the soap, so you use hand sanitizer. Very good. Yeah, so we find ways to clean up, right? And do you think that washing hands is important?
Mm-hmm.
Why is it important?
Oh,
yeah, because you don't get all dirty and then get everything else dirty, and then you touch your toys and then you touch your food, and then where does that go?
Belly.
In your mouth and then in your belly, and that's not good, right? So then it's very important. So you listen to your parents, to your teachers, to anybody else, and then you wash your hands, right? And this is something that, guess what? Today we have Jesus fighting with the Pharisees, some people who were called the Pharisees and the scribes, about washing hands. And Jesus' disciples were traveling with Jesus, and then they came to eat, and guess what they didn't do?
Wash their hands.
Do you think that was good?
No,
right? They should have washed, right?
They would probably get sick.
They would probably get sick, you're right. So then these people, the Pharisees and the scribes, were not very happy with Jesus, and they said, why are your disciples not washing their hands? They should be washing their hands, right? And then Jesus says, well, you're right, that is important, that is very important that we do, but what is important too is that you listen to my word, because we get so focused on washing hands and the traditions that we have that they're not bad, but when we focus so much in ourselves, in our hands, and we are just here, we forget who has given us the water and the soap and our health and our life, and we forget all about Jesus, right? So we can say every time that we're washing hands, we can say, oh, thank you, Jesus, for giving us our water, for giving us soap, for giving us everything that we need from day to day, and we are still going to wash our hands and remember that Jesus is with us always, all right? Yes? Yeah, so we don't get sick. And then when you forget to wash your hands and then you're eating already, what are you going to do?
Wash your hands even before that.
So we need to remember that. So, but sometimes we forget, right? Yeah, so then we pray to God and we say, oh, please, Jesus, don't let me get sick, right? And then we just keep eating. Right? All right, let's pray. Dear and Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for giving us your Son to come and cleanse our hearts and our minds and give us your word so that we hold on to you only. And we give you thanks for all the blessings that you give us to keep us healthy and well. We ask you that you continue to be with us this week, and that whatever we do, we trust that you are with us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. All right. Thank you. And congregation, please stand for our gospel acclamation.
Thank you.
seventh chapter. Now, when the Pharisees gathered to him with some of the scribes who had come from Jerusalem, they saw that some of Jesus' disciples ate with hands that were defiled, that is, unwashed. For the Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they wash their hands properly, holding to the tradition of the elders. And when they come from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they wash. And there are many other traditions that they observe, such as the washing of cups and pots and copper vessels and dining couches. And the Pharisees and the scribes asked him, "Why do your disciples not walk according to the tradition of the elders, but eat with defiled hands?" And Jesus said to them, Well did Isaiah prophesy of you hypocrites, as it is written, "These people honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men. You leave the commandments of God and hold to the tradition of men." And Jesus said to them, "You have a fine way of rejecting the commandment of God in order to establish your tradition. For Moses said, 'Honor your father and your mother,' and whoever reviles father or mother must surely die. But you say, 'If man tells his father or his mother, whatever you would have gained from me is Corban, that is, given to God,' then you no longer permit him to do anything for his father or mother, thus making void the word of God by your tradition that you have handed down. In many such things you do." This is the gospel of our Lord. You may be seated. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, cleanliness is something that we spend our time and our energy all of the time, or at least so it seems, from our bodies to our spirits to our homes, washing dishes, doing laundry, etc., etc. This is something very important to us because this means health. This means that we can take our lives and have them be well for a little longer before we actually get sick because somebody else was not taking their precautions. So we must be clean ourselves. And we spend our time and our effort in this so much that cleanliness, we take cleanliness to a whole different level. And we could even call it a religious level, where cleanliness, physical or spiritual, become our own religion. And our time and energy is spent there. We are consumed by this purity and cleanliness program and project that we have for our lives, whether it is for our own bodies or for our spirit, so that we are not like those who are not taking their precautions, so that we are not like those who are unclean. And we try to separate ourselves from those people. So we are seeing today, as he usually does, that Jesus now takes on the power of religion for the sake of faith. Because it is this faith alone that makes you and me righteous, holy, believers, and forgiven. And here we need to make the distinction between religion and faith. Between being religious and having faith. Not here that I am not saying, as others do, that we should reject religiosity, religion, or Christianity for the sake of spirituality, as some people might try to distance themselves from the church and Christianity, saying, "I am not religious, I am just spiritual." As if Christianity in itself is corrupt and foul. We, of course, can say, well, the church is not perfect because, well, it's filled with sinners like you and I. But when we gather with in the Word, that is what makes us clean and holy. So the distinction that I am making is here is that there is a great big difference between religion and faith. Faith is God's work in us. He sends His Holy Spirit through His Word and the sacraments, preaching, baptism, and Holy Communion to take hold of us, to bring our hearts to rest in Him, so we look to Him for everything good. Count on Him in every time of difficulty, and trust in Him to care for us day by day. This is faith. It is because of this relationship that God establishes with us through Christ Jesus that the faith that He gives us starts to spill over and do good. And not only do good, but actually believe in the promises of Christ. So when you are cared for, protected, and loved like that, you naturally stop worrying about your self-preservation and start looking at your neighbor in confidence and hope that God has got you and your neighbor and all that you need from day to day. So, faith spills over. Faith cannot be contained. And this same faith is not worried about what commandments God has demanded of you, what you should do or you should not do. But instead, this faith has already done them before the question about God and His commandments has even been asked. It's already done, and you worry no more. We see then that unlike faith, religion is a human enterprise. And the critics of the church are very right in that aspect. Faith is something God does to us and in us. Religion is something that we do in and to ourselves. Religion has all the characteristics that we do. It is sometimes beautiful, sometimes powerful, but it is also sometimes flatulent. That is stinky and unintelligent, to put it lightly. That is religion for you. Sometimes beautiful and sometimes even stinky. Sometimes our religiosity can barely get out of bed because the demand is too great and we are too tired trying and doing over and over again. And religion is full of hypocrisy. It is full of loopholes because religion is a human enterprise. It is a human business. And as our business, we look to protect it at all costs, even when it causes all sorts of trouble. And this religion, I'm not talking only about Christianity or anything else, but everything else that we have in our life can become a religion. We are consumed by it. We look how we justify our actions and inactions because inevitably we will fall short because we have placed the bar too far from our reach. And even when we have it within our reach, that even then we fall short. And this is what we see Jesus doing. Jesus takes on our religiosity head on. He takes on our religiosity. Jesus exposes our hypocrisy and He sheds light on who we truly are. And in who and in what we truly trust. That is our own doing, ourselves, our attempts at making ourselves righteous and worthy before our neighbor, and most importantly, before God, as we look to make ourselves good and clean and pure. And the prophet Isaiah says that, well, when we get into this enterprise and business of religiosity, of religion, he says, you turn things upside down. Shall the potter be regarded as the clay, that the thing made should say of its maker, he did not make me? Or the thing formed say of him who formed it, he has no understanding, but I do. So the interaction between Jesus, the Pharisees, and the scribes at a glance seems to be a little bit over the top, a little bit exaggerated. Fighting about washing hands? Really? Who would do that? Who would fight whether this is a good idea or not? Of course, you know. You and I know that it is a good idea. Even the children know what you should be doing. And it seems that Jesus is in the wrong here for once. Jesus and his disciples had not only been surrounded by crowds of people who brought their ill to them, they also had been traveling. And you very well know that whether by foot, by car, boat, plane, train, or any other way, you will get dirty. So washing up is the least you can do. The tradition of the elders, when we look at it, is nothing short of great. The Pharisees and all the Jews, except Jesus and his disciples, of course, did not eat unless they washed their hands. But they did not do it as many of us do. They washed their hands, and they did it properly, singing their ABCs, washing for at least 20 seconds, right? Washing with water and soap, washing from their wrist to their fingertips, washing between their fingers too. This does not seem like an irrational request, right? How many times have you told your children or grandchildren, did you wash your hands? With a follow-up question after hearing a doubtful yes. With soap and water, you reply. Well, in all honesty, many of us, if not all of us who are in contact with children, and a couple times even before we made it to church this morning. And it might be a little too early in the morning for you and a little too real, but as we are gearing up to the start of a new school year very soon, I have a friend who shared in her social media a study done by her school district. You might see where I'm going with this. Among middle school and high school age kids about washing their hands after using the restroom, and not let you use your imagination what they used it for. So since I cannot unsee it, neither can you now. You're welcome. The study says that 50% of middle and high school students wash their hands, and only 33% of females and 8% of males use soap. No, it surprised me that only 33% of females do that, but 8%, yeah, that sounds about right for males. You very well know that we are all stinky, and sometimes not. As we grow up, it's a little less and less, but we're still doing that. So I think the tradition of the elders that the Pharisees and the Jews were following does not sound that bad now, huh, Jesus? But notice here also that Jesus was not against them washing their hands properly. He was not opposed to hygiene, much less against public health. Not at all. What Jesus was exposing is what we do even now. Just in a very small scale, with the example of the study my friend's school district did, we can see how we can turn, how quickly we can turn in on ourselves. See how good we are doing, comparing ourselves to our neighbor who is doing better than the other, and lifting ourselves above those who do not follow our basic cleanliness, whatever that cleanliness might be, even cleanliness of thought and lifestyle and anything like that. We can only hear the girls saying to the boys how much better they are at washing their hands with soap and water. Sure, it is only 33% of the girls who do it right, but compared to the 8% of boys, they are doing much, much better, and they have the high ground saying, "We are better than you. Not perfect, but better." So you see how much we can turn anything about ourselves, proud about how well we are doing, or despairing for how awful we are. Our religiosity grows exponentially, especially when we see the smallest of opportunities to show how great we are, or at least that we are not as bad as our lousy neighbor. We turn our religiosity, our human enterprise, into our savior. As Isaiah says, we turn things upside down. We regard our maker as the clay, and we say to him, "You did not make me. I made myself. All you see I have, it's all mine and nobody else. It's all me. I pulled myself up by my bootstraps. Nobody did it for me." So we become blind, deaf, mute, and dense within ourselves in search for our own glory, that we forget that God, who is merciful to us, and our neighbor who needs us, is the one who has made us, who has called us, who has cleansed us. So we fall into ourselves as an open hole on the road that we can't see because we are so preoccupied looking up, trying to reach up for the stars. But thankfully, even when the Lord himself exposes us, telling us, "You have ears, but you cannot hear. You have eyes, but you cannot see. You have mouths, but you cannot speak. You have minds, but you cannot perceive. You have hearts, but you cannot feel. And even when you fall far away from me by your own doing, by your religiosity, whatever these might be, washing your hands properly and looking with disdain to the unclean, the smelly, or anything else, even when your hearts are far from me and you fear me because of the commandment of human enterprise, I will not pay you as you deserve. Instead, as Isaiah reminds us, I will do wonderful things with you, with wonder upon wonder, with abundance upon abundance, with mercy upon mercy." So, listen to the good news of God for you in Christ Jesus. Even though you fall into yourselves and away from God, either because of pride that you feel and think you are doing so great that you do not need your Maker any longer, or because of despair, because you feel and think that you do not deserve His forgiveness and love, and are far away from Him because of either one of these situations, He actually follows after you. He searches for you. He finds you. He forgives you, and He makes you anew. God's mercy and grace is such that He makes the word to fall on you. Christ Himself grabs a hold of you. You are no longer fallen and far away, but you are risen and brought close to him. So, what shall we say about this religiosity enterprise, about washing our hands? Should you no longer need to wash your hands properly with soap and water for at least 20 seconds, singing your ABCs because of Christ's grace and mercy? Because Christ has forgiven you, you do not need to follow basic hygiene? No, not at all. Please, I ask you, no, this is not what we are talking about. This is not what Jesus is saying. And everyone will thank you for it. But even for as religious as you might be about cleaning up, washing up, and fulfilling God's commands to a T, and your human enterprise, none of this is going to make your heart clean. This does not make you righteous before God. It only maintains your appearance and holiness before your neighbor. But Jesus is not interested in any of this, not because it is not important for you to wash your hands or try to fulfill God's commands, but because it is God's word who is the power of faith. And this faith is a gift for you today, tomorrow, and always. Religion and religiosity always seek for loopholes, itself and its gratification, but faith always rests in Christ Jesus and rejoices in him. So, go ahead and wash your hands properly, if you wish, that Christ has got a hold of you already. He has given himself for you. He once again comes to sanctify you and to cleanse you, to give you peace and to give you comfort and to give you rest from all that turning and doing. He once again comes to you, not with soap and water and not even with hand sanitizer, but by the washing of water with his word in your baptism. This is the true and only cleansing you need, which can only and does only come from Christ to you and for you. And now, my dear brothers and sisters in Christ, you are spotless and without blemish because Christ himself has made you his own in his abundant forgiveness and mercy for you now and forevermore. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Please join me in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are known, grant us true faith, that we honor you not only with our lips, but believe you faithfully with all our heart, mind, and strength. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, preserve us from rejecting your commandments for human teachings. By your Spirit's help, lead all Christians to keep your commandments in thought, word, and deed, honoring you in all that we do. Most importantly, place your gospel in our ears so that we believe your promises and bear abundant fruit. Lord, in your mercy. Merciful God, hear our prayers for our nation and its leaders, for all civil servants, and for first responders and all whose work imperils them for the sake of their neighbor. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Lord, in his early earthly ministry, your Son healed the sick and comforted the hurting. Grant healing and peace to those taking treatments, to the ill or injured, to the lonely and the imprisoned, and to all in need of our prayers, especially our brothers and sisters in Christ, who we hold in our minds and hearts, that in meekness each hurting heart would obtain fresh joy in your Son and exult in you, Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Please share that peace with one another.
Please rise as you are able. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, we give you thanks and praise that you bless us with all we need from day to day. In your abundance, continue to bless us, providing for our physical and spiritual needs. Help us be good neighbors to those around us, and give us the faith to trust you alone through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it all to drink, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us pray together the prayer our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. I'd like the communion assistants to please come forward. We'll be communing at the altar today. If you need gluten-free communion, let myself or Pastor Horacio know. And the lighter liquid is grape juice and the darker is wine. If you are not yet receiving communion and would like to come forward for a blessing, you may keep your hands at your sides and we'll know to give you that blessing. These are God's gifts for you, God's people. Come.
Thank you.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have forgiven our sin through the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. We pray that in your mercy you give us peace, assuring us your grace is enough. And we ask you to strengthen us in your life-giving faith, to live our lives in trust toward you and in love toward our neighbor, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Receive God's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord makes his face shine upon you with grace and mercy. The Lord looks upon you with favor and gives you peace. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Everybody, God.